started going back up again. We were excited about the optimism, and we saw July up from June, but then we saw a little downtick, and you can see here the numbers. They're not that far off of each other than a general drop from 2019. And I can tell you that, we had on the unique logins, again, how many people per month were logging into KCL platforms? Well, we're at around 2,600 on the average for these 5 months. That's about a 12% drop from 2019. So there are less people doing design work. Maybe there were too many before. I just think that the amount of work is down. People are doing more work themselves, maybe not outsourcing. So we're seeing the trend that, hey, we're down. We're down from 2019 by a lot. We're down from 2018 as well. Again, our big metric is the actions. And you see here, I mentioned early on that January of 2020 was our biggest month ever. Well, December of 2019 also. I'm not sure what optimism was going on, what was going on in the world, but everyone was, that we can see was doing design work. So actions, again, if you look at the blue for 2020, you see we are below. It's just a fact. There's less work. People are doing less, but it hasn't dropped off the charts. We're a little bit below 2 years ago, and I think a lot of this will match with, I know Robin was giving a lot of numbers yesterday and today in industry facts. Again, if you're in the takeout, carryout design area, you're busy. If you're doing fancy steakhouses, fine dining, right now there's really nothing happening other than people planning for the future. So we're seeing it. We don't have the December numbers yet. We're hoping it's not going to go down too much, but this hopefully gives you an idea of it's not horrible. We're going to get through this, and we know there's more optimism coming in the beginning of the year. And as I mentioned to Janelle over the last few days, this was really a good experiment for KCL to do a deeper dive into the numbers and having this opportunity to share to show everyone, hey, yeah, we're down. You can see that there's less work, but it's not dire straits. So then just to give, again, we're doing PowerPoints, we're doing charts, you can see it. This is just giving you kind of a year-to-year comparison. How many users? Well, again, we've been above that 3,000 a month last couple of years, the beginning of the year. You can see 2019 was pretty level. In 2020, again, we had that 10%, 12% drop in users. We're hoping to see that it stays stable, but we're a small company. We make phone calls to people to say, "Hey, if you're not renewing, would you tell us why?" And right now, the big answer is, "I just don't have design work." Now, that's not coming from your mainstay dealers and consultants. It's coming from more of our, I'm going to say, fringe users of there might be architects that say, "I do a couple designs. I don't have any restaurants that I'm working with anyone on." There may be outsource firms where if you're a consultant and you get busy, you outsource it. Well, if that you don't have work to outsource, they're not so busy. So we're definitely seeing a drop off. You can see where we are compared to the last 2 years. We're hoping that this will stay close to stable for December. Again, the big one is actions. This was a big drop. We talked about this, 60% drop in what people were doing. It's since recovered, gone up a little bit in the fall. And again, is it winter coming? We're not sure. Hoping that with the vaccine distribution that's out there, we're going to see an uptick in people, with confidence doing more design work. So again, the little simple arrows. Hey, we started great. We dropped big. It's going up, but not like it was. This is a little more representative of a quick study we did of some of the major chains like Yum! Brands, Chipotle, Subway, Domino's, McDonald's. They're all seeing that uptick because I think they also finally figured out how to handle the non-eat-in business, or some places are starting to open up a little more. So again, not horrible news coming, just maybe not that big jump that we were hoping for. So that's kind of the numbers. Here's a little bit of fun at the end, is that hopefully some of you know my dad, Ron. We started the company in 1985. Cameras were a little blurrier as well. And here we are now, 35 years later. We've changed logos a little bit. You might notice I have a little bit less hair, but I have definitely gained in wisdom over 35 years, and I've gained a little bit in weight as well. those things happen. We do wish we were able to celebrate in person with everyone, but as we're not able to, we got a little URL up here that for those that like their swag, I might need a little bit of help from Janelle here. I've got a link that I can pop in, but I don't see the chat window. So I'll get that in here in a minute that you can click on it. If you'd like us to send you out a little swag bag for the end of the year, we'd be happy to do that. Thank you very much for listening to us today. I hope this gives you some insight of where we were and where we're going. As always, please let us know if we can help you out. And there's my contact information.
Thanks a lot, Kevin. We'll make sure that we get that link for the swag bags to everybody who is participating today. Interesting data. We don't seem to have any comments, but I think everybody's just kind of digesting that. And it's interesting to see KCL's data because it definitely paints a better picture than I think what we anticipated. So it's good to see that. And we really appreciate that.
Well, thanks. And that was the idea, is that we haven't done this deep dive and, you know, the consultants, the design world, I know there's MAS consultants out there and sorry, we don't have a lot of info for that, but to show that the design world has not fallen off the face of the planet yet, it's good and it's going to get better. We're very confident. So I'll pop that link into a chat when it goes back to the regular window. But again, thanks for letting us participate today. We appreciate it.
All right. Thanks a lot, Kevin. Have a great day.
You too.
Let's jump on over to the PRNW Test Kitchen in Georgetown, Washington, where we have Chef Patrick Simon, Corporate Regional Chef for Wellbuilt and a recipient of the 2020 American Culinary Federation President's Award for Leadership. Patrick was also the 2012 ACF Chef of the Year for the Las Vegas chapter. Along with Patrick, we have Deb Fryer coming to us from Tampa, Florida. Deb is the Field Marketing Manager for Combotherm and Mary Chef, and is the liaison between the US region and factories in the UK and Germany. Deb leads the US sales and marketing strategy for these two brands. I wish we could be in attendance at the PRNW Test Kitchen today to enjoy the food that Chef Patrick will be cooking. The two of them will be cooking with combis. Over to you guys.
Sounds great. Let me go ahead.
Hello, hello.
All right, can you see my screen?
Not yet.
Yep, yes, there it is.
We can.
Okay, so I heard a yes along with the no, correct?
Yeah, you're good to go.
Excellent. All right, thank you so much. First of all, thank you everyone for joining us today to talk about combination, or more lovingly called combi ovens. Very straightforward agenda for this afternoon. We're going to talk about what a combi oven is and what types of applications it's mostly used for. We'll talk about the types of customers that are using combi ovens. Then we'll spend a lot of time talking about the right model to choose for your customers based on the types of things that they're cooking and their traffic peaks, as well as discuss main specification criteria and how to avoid potential issues that we see. So what is a combi oven? It's a cooking appliance that combines three heating technologies: convection, steam, and then when you combine the two, you actually have something called combi steam, which is, that's where the name comes from. The one thing that's really important when you're putting in combi ovens into your design is it does take some careful planning. You need to really understand the utilities that are available. You need to understand and really make sure you have high quality water for combis. They're very sensitive to water. And unfortunately, with the US adding more and more additives to the water supply, it becomes even more important today than ever before. A lot of times we'll talk to dealers and they'll say, oh, you know, I had a combi 30 years ago and it ran fine on a filter. Well, the water 30 years ago was very different than it is today. Also making sure there's access to a drain and making sure that it will fit in your footprint, and more importantly, that it will fit through the door. We do have some units people purchase and it gets to the site and they don't have any way to get it into the room. So that's a very important piece. So why are people moving to combi technology? And I always find it interesting that the US is actually behind the rest of the world in combi technology. And the reason is we still have a lot of space. So we design kitchens much larger than they do in a lot of cases overseas. And part of that is because with those historical buildings, that are 200, 300, 400 years old. They just didn't make buildings all that big back then. So it's really important for them to get a piece of equipment in their kitchen that can do a lot of different cooking methods. So what are the benefits? The big one is it's much faster than conventional cooking. So it really allows you to increase your table turns, do more with less labor. In addition, higher quality. You'll get higher quality in a combi than pretty much any conventional piece of equipment. And that's because the airflow quality is very, the tolerances are very tight. The temperature control is very tight. And also the ability to either quickly remove moisture or add moisture during the cooking process also really helps improve the quality of anything that you produce in a combi. And there are lots of savings. I know if you go to the Fishnick page, you can look at some of the case studies that they've done on introducing some of the new technologies. So there's a lot of great information there. We also have case studies on convotherm.com as well that you can look at to really see some of the savings. So labor is a big one. Very straightforward way to do that is because combis are generally hands-free cleaning. You literally, you know, either put in the chemicals or the chemicals are already attached. You hit go and you no longer have to pay someone a half an hour, an hour to clean, like for example, a convection oven or a steamer. It's completely self-cleaning. Generally, also you'll see energy savings over conventional equipment. In most cases, you'll see higher yield, again, because of that ability to maintain very tight tolerances, as well as inject that moisture into the cavity during cooking, and then also savings on space. And the really big one is menu expansion. So let's go to the next slide here. And what I have along the top is four very common pieces of equipment that you'll see in a lot of different kitchen designs. You have the combi oven first, the convection oven, the steamer, and the fryer. And then along the left, a lot of very common cooking methods. So when you're making your design, and especially if you need to put this equipment under the hood, if you look at a convection oven, which is generally about 3 linear feet under that hood, a convection oven really does two things well. It will bake. Oh, I just realized that my thing's moved. So it'll bake and it'll roast. So in those 36 inches, you're really delivering only two cooking methods. The second, if you look at a steamer, right, and there's many sizes of steamers, but the steamer can do one thing and that's high temp steam. And a fryer we all know and love can do one thing and that's deep fry. But if you think about combi technology, combis can actually do everything on this page. So we talked about the fact that in smaller kitchens, you'll see combis and it's because of the fact that they can use one piece of equipment in a very small footprint and it can do a lot of the things that that chef wants to do on their menu. The other benefit here is it really allows for that menu expansion. They may want to try something in sous vide. They may want to try something with overnight cooking or even smoking. And without having to buy a whole new appliance, they can do that right in their combi oven. Patrick, do you want to make some comments on this slide from a culinary standpoint?
Thank you, Deb. Absolutely. So as far as utilizing the combi technology, pretty much any type of operation from a hospital to a hotel, restaurant chain, they can utilize this technology. And the beauty part about it is, with the majority of the manufacturers' combi ovens that are out there, the cooking profiles can be programmed in. And so we have really established and consistent products coming out of the oven going out to our customers. So the beauty about working with the combis on a regular basis is the ability to be able to do exactly what I want to do, bake, smoke, roast, all of those things, and then sous vide some items. As well, do a lot of overnight cooking. So yes, it's a very functional piece of equipment, just like you said earlier, with a very small footprint that it would take up. So thank you.
Good, thank you. That's a great segue, Patrick, into the types of customers that are perfect for combis. And really any location that's making hot food should be a candidate. The next couple of slides, we're gonna get into the full line, and you're going to find that we have very small footprint combis. I think the kitchen mic is still on, as well as very large. So it can really fit in almost any area. So starting at the top, schools is obviously very big from a combi perspective. They really like doing stacked units so that they can use two different methodologies at the same time, cooking methodologies at the same time. We're seeing a lot of influx into healthcare as well. Third is that senior living, where food is really becoming a draw to getting people to move into different senior living situations. If you go to the websites of these companies, you're going to see that a lot of times they're very food forward. They talk about the chefs that they have on staff. They show pictures of beautiful meals. And think about it, if the grandkids are going to come and have a fantastic meal, they're more likely to want to continue to visit their grandparents. To the far right, we have fine dining, which has always been a staple of combi ovens. To the middle left, we have stadiums. This is a buffet and a suite. QSRs obviously use combis for many things. We have sports centers, we have cruise ships. On the lower left-hand corner, we have banqueting in large hotels or maybe Las Vegas. Retail is very big. In fact, rotisserie chickens are going through the roof, and combi technology is a great way to make roasted chickens in the grocery stores in about 30 to 50% the time versus other methods of making roasted chicken. Military is also a big one for us because they're feeding so many people in a short period of time, and because of the speed that combis can work with, that's a benefit. And then also we're seeing a lot of growth in the C-store channel as well. All right, and with that, I'm going to turn it back over to the kitchen.
You guys are muted.
All right, folks, we are back in the Performance Reps Northwest Test Kitchen, and we're going to cook a variety of different items inside our Combotherm C4 Easy Touch with a two-stage door handle and disappearing door feature. We have some beautiful Alaskan salmon fillets. We're going to do some grilled asparagus, and we're going to grill some lemon as well. We're going to put that in. We're also going to cook at the same time some wild rice and rice pilaf combination. And then we're going to prepare for dessert some chocolate molten cakes. Everything happening at the same time with no cross transfer and flavor. Utilizing our tray timers. And going all the way through. Everything being cooked simultaneously. There we go. All right, we are all set, folks.
All right, can you see my screen again?
Yep.
Okay, fantastic. I'm going to go through these next slides relatively quickly. I want you to know that this information does exist and we can look at it in detail later. But really, when you look at any combi line, they're going to have multiple different sizes from mini all the way to the big roll-in models. So first, the applications for the mini are really a lot of front of house or back of house. And they're great in smaller venues for either batch cooking, on-demand cooking, or holding. And we see these a lot in QSRs, in C-stores, cafes, and country clubs. Whenever you hear about a mini or a compact or an excess, they're going to be 4 to 10 shelves. Very few take the 2/3 GN trays. Most will take the half sheet tray and hotel pans. And these are the same descriptions you'll see on AutoQuotes. The second is what they call tabletop. Those are units with between 5 and 11 shelves. They can be half size or full size sheet pans. You'll see a lot of customers stacking these for the ultimate flexibility. So you'll see these in restaurants, schools, healthcare, and military. Next, we have floor models. These are all about production. They all include a roll-in trolley. You'll see these in stadiums, hospitality, food production, corrections, cruise ships, and bakery. These are generally 12 to 20 shelves in both half or full size sheets. And then from an option standpoint, one of the things you'll see is there's a lot of variation by brand on the type of steam generation they provide, whether they do generator, which they'll call boiler, or boilerless, which they'll also call injection or potentially spritzer. You'll see that some of the brands offer only electric models. So as you're choosing a combi brand, be sure to understand what fuel types they do offer. For the most part, you'll see right-hand door standard with options of left-hand door or disappearing door. Many of the units you can use with smokers, as well as grease pump systems, which are generally added at the factory, and marine and corrections packages are also available. All right. As we said, not all brands have all of the sizes and models shown here, and many brands will offer only one steam type. And the other thing I would caution you is that the descriptions and auto quotes to the left are not always correct. So do check the spec sheet. So for example, it'll say a model is a generator, but when you look at the spec sheet, it'll say that it is in fact a boilerless unit. So just a little bit of caution there. I'm gonna go through these next three slides very quickly. I like to break the category into three main kind of segments. The first is what I consider the main players, with Rationale and Ultosham holding between 70 to 80% of the market share in the US, Convotherm third, and then Blodgett. I'm not gonna go through all of these in detail. You'll see that in every case, all three brands carry both electric and gas. However, Blodgett, you'll have to look at the model. Sometimes they have boiler or sometimes they have boilerless. Rationale is primarily generator, Ultosham primarily boilerless. Convotherm carries both generator and boilerless in every size except for the mini. So when you're looking at specifying a piece of equipment, make sure that you understand what those brands have in their lineup. The other thing is some of the units are made outside of the USA. The only three that I can find that have stock models or quick ship programs are Rationale, Ultosham, and Convotherm. And at the bottom here, I have the number of units that they have available in auto quotes. So Convotherm has 54 models available on either quick ship or stocked models. And then you can see Rationale 16 and Ultosham 8. The other thing I've included are the number of units that are Energy Star. Again, I would caution you here because how a brand defines a model varies. For example, some brands will say their left-hand door is one model and the same model and the right-hand door is another model. So that's going to look like it's double the number of Energy Star models compared to, for example, a Convotherm, where we don't break it out by door type. So just be careful. Don't look at just the number in Energy Star. Really dig in and understand the details. The second tier players, Lennox, Vulcan, BKI, Electrolux, Hennepenny, Georg, which is a new brand this year, and Bakemax. The ones in yellow, I would just put a little bit of caution there where there's some inconsistencies from size to size in terms of fuel type and steam type. So you really have to look at the spec sheets when you're looking at different sizes to make sure that you know what you're getting. None of these models have stock in the US, again, based on auto quotes. So if there is a different program, I'm not aware of. And then again, I have listed the Energy Star models. Most of the smaller players do not have any Energy Star models because it is a little bit of an investment to make that happen. And then finally, what I'll call the value players, the Angela Posey, Lomas, I'm not sure how to pronounce that, Technioka, and Unox. And again, I won't go through the details here, but I do have it for anybody who wants to take a look. Anecdotally, what we hear about the value players is generally they are slow to recover after a cook cycle, and they do very well with one or two shelves of product, but with a full load, they tend to struggle a little bit more. They don't have as much browning consistency from shelf to shelf. All right, so a couple of differentiating factors, and I know that we're running short on time. Quick note, ConvoTherm is sustainable and socially responsible. Our factory uses biomass heating and green energy, which is hydroelectric power. We save over 775,000 kilograms of CO2 per year by doing it this way. We talked about the fact we have ENERGY STAR models, and we also have very low water utilization models relative to the competition. And we have a lot of certifications. I won't go through the details here. I know you're familiar with all of these. So Patrick, I'd love to turn it over to you and have you talk a little bit about an open versus closed system, if that would be okay.
Absolutely. Thank you, Deb. I appreciate that. So as you could see from the picture here, the big difference is, you know, the open versus closed, and we love to be able to show the difference between the two. With an open system, as you could see, the pot that's uncovered on the stove, you're getting all of the escape of all the energy, all of the water vapor coming out of the actual oven. So it's kind of like when you want water to boil a little bit faster, what do? You put a lid on it, like we have here in the picture. You put a lid on that, and that's what we did with our ConvoTherm product line, is we put a lid on the inside of that actual unit, so you're not going to get the escape from. And if you take a look over here, you can actually see I'm cooking in combi mode right now on this, in the C4 620, and you're getting very small little bursts of energy coming out. So we're pulling our items out. This is a working kitchen here in the Performance Reps Northwest kitchen. Disappearing door, we have items coming in and out. So, and I slam door feature. So to answer the question, open versus closed, okay? The closed system is gonna work a lot more efficiently. It's gonna use a lot less energy, and it's gonna use a tremendous amount less water than a traditional open system, which a lot of the competitors that are out there have that open system that we've come to see, where they have the stack, actually all of the water vapor coming through it.
Fantastic, thank you. And the other thing I would add to that is the fact that there's a lot less grease-laden air emitted with a closed system versus an open system. And we're gonna show you an example of that in just a second. So Patrick talked about, and he showed us the condensation. What we have here are actually two units side by side, and the circles or the obelisks are on the left is brand A and on the right is brand B. And you can definitely see the condensation leaving the brand B unit. And that actually adds up to quite a bit of water being used over a year. So if you look at brand B, that single unit will use enough water to fill a backyard swimming pool in terms of excess water versus brand A. So very important benefit. Another differentiating feature I'd like to talk about other than the closed system is the hands-free versus chemical handling cleaning. So with hands-free, that's generally a liquid attached to a hose. With hands-on, the employees are expected to handle the chemicals and place them into the unit. We see liquid as being safer. However, as you're planning your designs, you will have to find a home for the liquid, especially in the case of a stacked or a roll-in appliance. Tabs are easier to find a home for because they don't need to necessarily be near the combi. However, you are asking employees to handle a caustic chemical. And if there is a power outage, there's a chance those tablets won't fully dissolve, and they, in a lot of cases, are in the fan baffle area. So just something to think about. The other thing to look at is serviceability. Some of the metrics to review in terms of spec sheets or installation manuals, do they have centralized service available? Meaning, is there an 800 number that customers can call to get their unit serviced? How many service hatches does the appliance have? More hatches are better, right? Gets you faster to the parts you need. How many critical spare parts are required? Do they need common tools or uncommon tools? That really tells you how quickly the FAS will be able to get in and out of there. The other differentiating feature is really think about the pre and post sales support. So if you have a brand that only plays in one or two categories, it's easy for them to make the sale and walk away and go on to the next customer. Versus a brand that has multiple categories, they need to create a relationship with that customer that's going to be long going. So one of the things to do is really look at word of mouth, look at past customer testimonials in terms of how much support did they get from that brand. Also warranty, warranties vary quite a bit in the combi world. They're most of them are laid out in auto quotes. And also some brands like Combotherm do have special K-12 warranties. In our case, we have 3 years parts and labor. I believe we're the only brand in the US that has that. The other thing is watch for warranty changes. With the advent of connectivity, we now have brands that are telling customers that unless they connect the appliance and send the data to the factory, that the unit will not be covered by warranty. Look for installation services. It's a great way to save time and give you peace of mind. Just look at the fine print, see what the installation services cover. And then finally, ventless. When you look at ventless, understand, do they mean ventless with an integrated hood or do they mean ventless without any hood at all? And the other thing I will tell you is the certificate itself doesn't tell the whole story. So ask for the actual details from the test. And I'm going to walk you through this example very quickly of two different brands, because on the surface, if you looked at the certificate or you looked at what the reporting, you would say, these brands are pretty similar. The one on the left has 1 milligram per cubic meter. The one on the right has 2. So at that point, you're saying, you know what, brand B is only 20% more, emits more grease-laden air than brand A. However, and here's where some brands will, I don't want to say trick the system, but they will set up their test for success. So on the left, brand A has 6 shelves. They did a total of 30 chickens, full chickens on 6 shelves, so 5 chickens per shelf, or about 94 pounds. Brand B had a total of 16 possible shelves. This was a stacked configuration, and they did 20 chickens. And Patrick, I'm going to pick on you here in a minute. So they only put 1.25 chickens per shelf. So Patrick, my question for you is, in the real world, when you're out there, you know, cooking for your customers, how often are you putting only 1 chicken per shelf when you're cooking?
Never, Devin. That was, I think, a little smoke and mirrors by that particular manufacturer doing that. So that would never happen in the real world. Chefs and culinary staff are going to try and put as much product as they possibly can feasibly into an oven. So the brand B obviously tried to, trick the system and really report something that isn't really working well. And it is working well in their favor, but it's not realistic and it's never going to happen. So thank you for adding me in there.
Yep, of course. So another way to look at it, when you get the data, rather than just look at their reported grease emissions, calculate the grease emission per pound of chicken cooked, and that's going to give you a better indication for how much grease is actually being emitted into the air. So in this case, when you do it on a per pound chicken cooked, you see that brand B is actually emitting about 84% more grease than brand A. So just something to think about. All right. I think I'm going to skip over. Patrick, are you ready to do your part? I'll skip over this piece if you are.
No, we're still going. So go ahead and feel free to keep going through your presentation. Thank you though for checking.
All right, sounds good. So now let's talk about specification and avoiding common mistakes. As I said earlier, water quality is really critical. In fact, some brands offer only RO systems with their units because they find that depending on what part of the country you're in, filters just are not doing the job. And again, that has more to do with the municipality and the chemicals they're putting in the water than the combis themselves. We always recommend, when in doubt, put in an RO system. We are now offering RO systems at a net price. Some of our competitors are as well, because we want to bring that cost down for those RO systems. Obviously, understanding if it's gas, is it LP or natural? Is it electric? What voltage? Specifically, what steam type do you want and why? If they're open to suggestions, Sometimes we look at water quality. For bad water quality, we may steer them more to a generator type. So a lot of open questions there. Understand the GFCI recommendations and suggestions for each brand. That's very important early in the design. And then we talked about having access to drain and access to cold potable water. From an operations standpoint, we already talked about, will it fit through the door? And the other big piece, and Patrick, this is where, you know, yourself and your team members come into play, is really understanding their menu. What are they trying to cook? I'll actually throw it over to you. How do you have those discussions with your customers to help them determine the right size and the right quantity of combis they should include?
Thank you, Deb. It really comes down to, you know, menu-driven oven selection. So if we're talking about a hotel or a hospital or a school, for that matter, based on the number of students, the larger volume, we're going to be suggesting some of the maybe floor-type models and or stacked units. And where we look at, are they going to be putting in hotel pans or are they going to be putting in sheet pans? You know, asking the questions, how they're going to prepare items. Is there a sense of urgency that there's a certain timeline that they have to hit? Like, for example, in a school, do we have at 12:50, does everything have to be prepared, just like you have on the screen here? Or in a hotel, in a banquet type situation, how often they're going to be preparing items, and how big of banquets that they're actually preparing for. Is it going to be 200 people or is it going to be 20,000 people? You know, I live in Las Vegas and we do events for, 20, 30,000 people at any given time. So it's really important from a chef standpoint to understand the technology and really understand what unit's going to benefit me the best.
Fantastic. Thank you. And then finally, always rely on, whether it's your regional factory chef, your reps, or your dealers, you can bring your menu items in and test them out in the combi and really work towards your gold standard so that when your customer is ready to buy, they are very confident that the piece of equipment they're purchasing is going to do what they need it to do. All right, Patrick, are you ready to turn it? Am I ready to turn it over to you, or do you want me to continue?
We're ready to go.
All right, I will stop sharing.
All right, folks, can everybody see that beautiful food we just prepared utilizing the C4? You can see the salmon, nice grilled wild-caught salmon, some rice pilaf, the lemons and asparagus that were grilled, and then for dessert, some chocolate molten cakes to kind of top it all off. All of it being cooked at the same time, what we would refer to as a mixed load. And that really comes down to the technology and the thought processes. With an open system, an open combi system, you're going to get potentially cross transfer and flavor. Whereas in a closed system, you're not going to get the cross transfer and flavor. So we're able to prepare fish, rice, vegetables, and a dessert all at the same time with no cross transfer and flavor. Doesn't that look great?
Yeah, that does look great. It's too bad we can't be there in person to try it out, man. It looks a lot better than my microwave lunch.
Sounds good. Yeah, I mean, all of those things, being able to prepare at the same time, is definitely a time saver from a chef and a culinary standpoint. And the thought process of actually having all of your cooking profiles created so that it is just a touch of an icon and prepare the item. So there's really no culinary training that's needed. And in this particular sense, with our press and go feature, you have the ability to be able to do that as well. Janelle, we have some questions.
So I'm actually going to, if you want to move to the Q&A, I'm actually going to kick this off and try to spur some people. From a design standpoint, oftentimes our clients have, they're more concerned about whether it's boilerless or a boiler. You know, from, I think from my standpoint anyway, I won't speak for everybody, but I think as designers, we really don't care. We tend to just go with what the client is asking for. So I think it would be beneficial if we could talk about the differences between boilerless and boiler systems and what we should know as consultants to help us have that conversation with our clients.
Oh, no, that's great. That's a great question, Tim. So thank you. So the real difference is, you know, and what I always tell, you know, our customers and clients is I say, if you're you have problems with hard water, if you have a lot of magnesium, potassium, and or calcium in your water, and you obviously, we always want to recommend a filtration system and or reverse osmosis system to go along with the combi, because like Deb alluded to earlier in the day or earlier in the presentation, that that water is very important, that what's going inside of it. So if you have problems or have concerns with hard water, I always recommend going with a boiler system. And if I don't have those particular challenges, then a spritzer or a boilerless type oven would be fine. So as far as performance, they're virtually the same. So if you're talking to the chef, you know, you can let the chef know that they're virtually the same as far as the performance is concerned. But really what it comes down to is when we see in the hotel environments, Tim, is that a lot of times the engineering or maintenance teams, they don't want to have to clean the boiler because it takes a little bit of time and a little bit of know-how to be able to do that. So they sometimes a tendency to go with the spritzer or the boilerless type models. But I will tell you, if they have a problem with hard water, that if the filtration system is not working properly, you're going to get that buildup of, you know, of hard water inside. So we can always replace the boiler, but we can't replace the cavity of the oven. So if we get a very big buildup inside that oven cavity, there's nowhere to go with it. So it really comes down to me is recommending to one of your clients is, you know, how's the water? You know, how's your water in your area? You know, is it really hard? And even with a filtration system, sometimes it still is a little bit hard. They're still getting some minerals that are in there. So I always recommend, like I said, the boiler type unit versus the boilerless based on water.
That's great information. I appreciate that. So Sam would like to ask, how does the closed system help stop the flavor transfer? Can you talk about that a little bit more?
Sure, absolutely. So, you know, I can't speak to other manufacturers, but I can speak to Combotherm. So we have a water barrier that's actually built in to our oven. So as we're getting the circulation from the fan inside, as the flavor is, or the flavor transfer is about to happen, we're getting all of that captured in with the water. The water, the steam that is generated is actually being drawn in to this water pellet. So you're not gonna get that flavor transfer. Now, when you have an open system, it's just gonna come straight out the stack and it's gonna go through the product. So you're gonna get that transfer of flavor all the way through the system. Does that make sense? Through the food.
I think it does. So Sam says, very helpful, thank you. Let's go back to talking about water filtration. And then also I'd like to ask about chemicals for cleaning. Does your combi need to have a specific water filter and a specific cleaning system? Because a lot of times I think as designers, we run into, especially I know I do, especially in the B&I market, you run into operators that don't want to get tied into a specific chemical manufacturer or supplier, and also a specific water filtration system that they have to have. They want everything to be universal and standard across their campus, right? So can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Filtration system, you know, and RO system for that matter, it comes down to the designer, the consultant, and the end user preference for us. But as far as chemicals are concerned, we have recommended chemicals that we want to have used inside of our ovens. So I think that the majority of the manufacturers that are out there, okay, have something similar. But I can say that our system, the cleaning system, it's touch free, so it's hands free cleaning. So it is just the pushing of a button. And then the end user can walk away and it's self-cleaning. So the oven's going to clean itself. But in certain respects or in certain manufacturers, you have to take a tablet, you have to open it up, you have to put it inside. Most of the time it doesn't dissolve. Not speaking, you know, about one particular manufacturer or the other, but the thought process is, you know, if I could have it where my employees, the liability of them not coming in contact with a toxic chemical, it's better for me, and it keeps my employees a lot more safe. But to answer your question, Tim, yes, we recommend to utilize our chemicals. If you want to use your filtration system, we have certain ones that we recommend. We have RO systems that we recommend. But, you know, it really comes down to checking with the manufacturer, checking with us, and reaching out to, in this case, would be Performance Reps Northwest, reaching out to them to make sure that particular RO system or filtration system that you're wanting to recommend, if it's compatible with our oven or that particular manufacturer's oven.
All right, thank you for that. I think that closes up our Q&A for this session. I appreciate you guys' information there, and the food looks great. I wish I could be there with you in person, and I'm sure everybody else wishes they could be there as well to taste what you've cooked today. Thanks a lot, Patrick and Deb.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for having us. Appreciate it.
Okay, before we hand over the controls to our next guest speaker, I want to take a minute and reflect on all the great information that's been shared over the past few days. I also want to take a minute to thank all of our sponsors for this event: Well-Built, Jackson Warewashing Systems, Caddy, and Samick, and of course the entire PRNW team for hosting this event. You guys have been awesome and we really appreciate it. As we were building this agenda, we were looking at a way to bring this session to a close that really left us with ideas and visions of how to tackle 2021 head on. And our next guest speaker is going to help us do just that. He'll help us understand the world of social media and the important role that it can play in keeping each of us relevant. Rich Malachy is the CEO of Malachy Parts and Service, a certified CFESA company in New Jersey that provides factory authorized commercial cooking, refrigeration, dishwashing, and food prep equipment service, maintenance, and installations. He's an industry thought leader and a content creator who has started the food equipment industry's first digital marketing conference and group, the Food Equipment Digital Disruptors, also known as the FEDD Group. Whether you're a technician, service company owner, manufacturer, director of marketing, or even a rep or dealer, Rich's brand of strategy and content will help you develop a new and fresh way to approach your business's marketing. Over to you, Rich.
All right. Thank you for that amazing introduction. Thank you, Janelle, everyone at Performance Reps Northwest, FCSI. Thank you so much for having me today. It's 5 p.m. here Eastern in Jersey. So I hope you guys are all having a great day. I'm going to jump into it. I'm going to share my screen. Hopefully this is going to work. Give me 1 second. I apologize. And okay. Hopefully everybody could see this.
Looking good on this end.
Looking good. All right. So I'm going to start from the beginning. So what we have here is we're going to talk a little bit about media disruption in the food equipment restaurant industry. I'm going to talk a little bit about branding. I do have a video to start. So if that's okay, I'd love to just play it. It's a couple minutes, so sit back and check it out.
Today's consumer doesn't want to be sold to on Facebook any more than they enjoy watching a commercial on their television. As social media has evolved, customers have evolved as well. Social networks today are much different than what they were 10 years ago. Today, they are publicly traded corporations which are in business to monetize their user data. Therefore, to have a chance at winning through social media marketing, you need to understand the rules and play within the boundaries of each social network. Social media isn't free, and it's not new anymore. It's a business. You need to find ways to stand out. In this presentation, I'm going to show you how to get the most out of social media for your business and teach you proven methods to make you a better marketer, grow your thought leadership, and create more engaging content for your business. No different than music moguls Drake and DJ Khaled. Now, I'm sure you've heard or seen the Shiggy Challenge, which to date has earned a whopping 7.3 million views on Instagram. Imagine when you add up everyone on the internet who participated, including Will Smith, Ciara, and Odell Beckham Jr., how many more views have been generated for the In My Feelings song, which has over 200 million views on YouTube. Today, people are brands. You are competing for attention against other corporations and also real people. Let's begin.
About nine now, right? Track, track, money, boo. And she got me in my feelings. Gotta be real with you. Yep. Kiki, do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. Cause I want you and I need you. And I'm down for you always, KB. Do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me. Cause I want you and I need you. And I'm down for you always.
Today's.
All right. So I hope that gave a little insight into some things we're going to talk about. We are all competing for attention online. That is a no-brainer. It's something that I've started some years back, and it's led me to today right here with you. So that's just a quick outline. I'm going to get right into it. We're going to talk about branding, how to create a brand for yourself. We're going to talk about some of the platforms. So diving right in, why brand yourself even if you work at a big corporation? So you'll see the first point, your career is in constant motion. And I put that there because whether you're, and listen, this is whether you're at a big corporation really or a small, but relevant really when you're working at those big corporations. I speak with guys that are in the manufacturers and some of the really big rep groups. And why do I need to brand myself? They're already a big entity. And I think the reason being, as we move forward into this new decade, is you need to set yourself apart, because we know that being in this industry, most people say once you start in this industry, it holds you. You never leave. You die in this industry, right? So you have to continue to evolve and understand that your thoughts matter, your ideas matter, and putting that in constant motion, whether you're at XYZ brand today and ABC tomorrow, because you don't know where your journey and your, you know, where your journey is going to take you. So you need to begin putting out that content because it's going to follow you wherever you go. You know, you want to be a spokesperson for your brand, but you know what? Like I said, I work with some of the big guys, Trimark and Singer. Maybe you're at Trimark today and you're at Singer the next day. Things happen, you evolve, you find opportunity. You need to continue to expand on your brand. So the next one is team. You know, you're ingraining yourself into the business and, you know, you need to become a part of the brand. You know, for me, I love my employees to be online, engaging, talking with other technicians, talking with manufacturers and reps that are putting things out. I want them to be a part of it. It's so important as we go in, again, into the next decade. So it's also a part of the differentiators. You know, we sit here, you know, as a service company, and we say to ourselves, okay, we're in a market that has maybe a dozen top-notch service companies just like us. What's our differentiators? You know, and when I look at it from the business aspect, it could be our warranty time. It could be that we're a certified Cefesa company. There's some things that differentiate us. But being online, you know, the ultimate differentiator is going to be you and your authenticity and your thoughts. Many people, you know, I talk to a lot of guys, a lot of girls, and they're all worried about starting and what I'm going to say. I will tell you now, there's never going to be a perfect time. There's never going to be, you know, the perfect thing to talk about. It's what's going on in your daily. You know, you are your differentiator. There's only one Rich Maliki. There's only one you. And when you begin putting these things out into the world, you're going to find people are going to be advocates for you. That's how you're going to continue to build, because people are going to be sharing and reposting and engaging with you. And it's going to be, we're going to talk about this, it's going to be the opportunities that you didn't know exist. So when we talk about branding ourselves, this is something, and I'll talk a little bit more about Fed Nation and what the Fed Group is, but when we were back in Miami, I put on our first conference, the Fed conference. It was amazing just before the pandemic hit. Thankfully, we got it in. But my presentation was labeled "Me and My Whys, You and Yours." So figuring out who you are. You know, I think at this stage of the game, we probably all know who we are, what we stand for, and only you know that, but the world is waiting to find out. So getting on LinkedIn, putting out video content on LinkedIn, putting out content on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube and all these media platforms that matter and whatever ones are coming down the pike, because there'll be new ones at some point. You need to let the world know who you are. It starts with the authentic you and then finding out why. Only you can answer what your whys are. For me, I'm building brand because I want to build business. Okay. Maliki Parts and Service here in New Jersey. I've dubbed the hashtag Maliki Cares. My business at Maliki Cares, that's my staple. That's the driving force of every day. Then came along Fed Nation, the Fed Group, the Food Equipment Digital Disruptors, which was a group that started on Facebook. And it started to really just take a life of its own. I did not know where this was headed, but I knew I wanted to build a community around my brand so we could start to build more awareness of what we're up to. What are we up to? The Fed Group right now is a community. It's got service techs. It has manufacturers, reps, dealers, consultants, there's chefs. There's no limit, really. It's everything embodying food service. And my why, again, the Fed Nation is going to be a business through the brands that I'm building. I want to put on networking events. We want to put together classes in schools or training classes that we could help with the new technicians that we want to bring into the industry, because there's such a gap. There's a lot of things that we're going to do over the next decade, and it's going to take time and, you know, understanding what people are going to remember you for. You know, I think that's a great way to even ask on one of your new posts that you're going to do. When you get off here, maybe go to LinkedIn and say, what does my brand speak of? What does my brand speak to you? And see what people come back with. I put that out not too long ago and a bunch of people came back, and a lot of it kept coming back to, you're the care guy, Maliki Cares. So people are remembering me for that right now. We'll see how that changes over time, but only you can decide, you know, who you are and why you're doing this. And that's something that you'll have to figure out as you go along. You know, and that comes back into knowing your audience, right? You have to define your audience. You have to target your market. For me, who is my audience? Everyone here today watching and who will watch is my audience. Every single channel partner, everyone that belongs to the FCSI, Cefesa, MAFSI, Beta, NAFM, you name it. Those channel partners, the people that are in those channels are all of my audience. I want them all to be part of the Fed Group and Fed Nation, because together I know we could be a bigger, stronger community and really tackle a lot of the issues and connect us. I look at the Fed Group as the conduit of the ultimate connector to all of these channels. So it's so important that we get more people involved. And you know, as you go along and you're finding out your whys, you're saying, I got to figure out who I am. What am I doing? Imitation is the biggest form of flattery. You've heard that before. For me, one of my gurus, one of my guys is Gary V. If you are not familiar with him, you could just go check out Gary. Just type in Gary V-E-E on YouTube and he will come up with a lot of videos. And I come from his early on, adopting his early on thoughts about community, consistency, content, just driving it, and being an imitation, reverse engineering, everything he's doing, exactly for what I need to do here in my business. So moving forward on talking about why brand your company if you're already successful. So success, it can come and go in an instant. You know, sitting up here with my dad so many years, you know, he would say, Rich, we got to make sure we're staying on track, staying ahead of the game, understanding, you know, what needs to be done next. And every morning, boom, 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 we can't miss a beat because we want sustainability. Okay, we need to be sustainable in everything we do, from the business aspect, from the media aspect, it's no different. Okay, we need you want sustainability when you get on this platform. And that's going to come back to one word, bottom right, consistency is key. It's everything. It's just like going to the gym. You know, if you go to the gym for a year, you're eating right, all of a sudden those abs are coming in, you said, I made it, I'm good. Once you stop, it goes away. The same thing that happens here. If you're not posting and engaging and being a part of the community that you're building on the platforms that matter, you can forget about sustainability. And what that will do is really the untapped opportunity. I wanted to speak about opportunity because, you know, you just don't know what opportunities exist until you begin this journey, sitting in front of your phone or a camera. So I'm here today. Quite honestly, this is an opportunity that I get today because of my journey 3-4 years ago. You know, Janelle and Performance probably would have never reached out to me had I not started putting out consistent content, just being myself, taking you around New Jersey and around the industry and showing what the food equipment industry is all about, showing what the service side is all about. It's led me here. And I don't know what's next, but I know I'm here and I'm doing this. And there's been business opportunities that have come from this. You know, speaking on national chain account levels, we're very national chain driven here as we build for the future. You know, Shake Shack, Chipotle, Qdoba, a lot of these things came from LinkedIn conversations, from LinkedIn posts of people sending people to my feed and saying, hey, check this guy out. Real business is happening. It does not happen overnight. That was 3 years in the making for Chipotle to happen. So you have to put in the work, you have to put in the effort. And talking about the conversations that are online, you know, yes, you're successful, okay? Your business is successful. People know you. They know who to call in your market. Great. What about online? There's a whole world online right now of conversations happening. And some of that could be directed directly at you. It could be directed at your business. It could be directed at employees. And if you're not there, you're not part of the conversation. You have no chance to control any of that narrative. Now, you know, you have Google reviews. There's all these different things. I respond to every single one, good or bad. And even the good. This is not just about the bad controlling narrative. You want to be there to engage with the good as well. I mean, it's, you know, when someone says something, hey, listen, let them know you're watching. You're a part of this online world. It's not getting past you. Thank you so much. You know, and employees see this. Employees see it. They see everything. They're watching. They're seeing who's leading the company. They're seeing where this company's headed. If it's just the same old, you know, I think, you know, complacency could kill a company. And, you know, that's why, you know, creating internal strength and building morale. I can't speak enough for that because, you know, I have my guys and my girls here and they see it and they're starting. It was slow rolling. Don't get me wrong. A lot of them are like, oh, we don't want to be on camera. Slowly but surely, they want to be on film. They want to be a part of it because this is, you know, when Malachi Cares is on their shirt, they're bearing that logo every day. They're proud to wear that logo. So very important. Now we're looking at how to create a brand for your company, knowing your audience. I really wanted to talk about the brands, about the platforms that we're all on today. When you look at the demographics, okay, you have YouTube, you have LinkedIn, you have Facebook, you have TikTok, Instagram is not there. But listen, YouTube is really a much younger demographic, I would say, but there's actually numbers you could look up. I'm not gonna get into all the numbers. If you wanna check out sproutsocial.com, that is sproutsocial.com. There's a lot of different statistics there about the demographics and age and gender and income and all the stuff that filters in to who's on these platforms. But from being on these platforms, you know, you gain some knowledge, you gain some gut feeling, you understand what you need to do where. You know, for this industry right now, and this may change, but for right now, LinkedIn is the most powerful platform that you need to be on every single day. If you don't have a profile, you need to get off. Once this is done, you're going to make a LinkedIn profile immediately. If you have an outdated profile, you're going to go update it. You're going to put a proper picture there. You're going to update everything about it, your about section, and then you're going to really begin to engage with the community at large. It's not just about posting, ladies and gentlemen. It is not just about posting. You can go days without posting. Fine. Be in the conversation. Is there someone that you're looking to work with? Is there someone that there's a customer out there that you have on your sites? Well, these people are all online. They're all posting. They're all engaging. It's kind of like, well, it's real life. It's real life. When you walk into I always use this example. You know, if I'm walking into a bar and I see a pretty lady that I like, and I'm not going to go sit next to her and say, "Hey, how are you? Let's get out of here." Right. I'm going to buy her a drink. I'm going to say, "Hey, what's your name? Where are you from?" We're going to get to know somebody. Same thing with LinkedIn. Okay. You're going to get to know people. You're not going to go right for the kill. Think about how many times someone comes into your DM or your message and says, "Hey, Joe here. Love to sit down and get on a demo with you and talk about SIP." Joe, I don't know you. You know, it's so important to know the platforms. YouTube, super important, especially for the reps. And I know I see a lot more of it happening now, which is great. Reps, manufacturers, training videos. Okay, I think it's super important for the training videos, especially for techs in the field. You know, technicians do use YouTube. They're YouTubing things all the time. And it would be nice to have all the manufacturers begin to get on board to show best practices on how to do certain things. And I actually, shout out to Revent, Tom and Brian, because I was just down there filming some videos for the training, and they're looking to do some more training videos. So I know that there's definitely, it's on people's minds, and you're going to see in 2021, I think we're going to begin to see an explosion of more videos from manufacturers. Facebook, of course, definitely a little bit of an older demographic. I know people are very big on politics on there. I don't get involved, especially being in business. I don't recommend, especially if you're an owner of a business, I don't recommend getting involved in politics talk. It could be detrimental. It really could. And TikTok, we're still working on TikTok. Okay. I just started. I'm thinking about for Fed Nation, beginning a Fed Nation TikTok where we're going to get the members involved. But that's really a fun platform right now. It's really fun. And you could do a lot of how-tos on there that are exciting and fun and engaging to a younger audience, especially as we try to look for sales operations and new people, new blood into the industry. It's going to be a great tool. And then Instagram, which is not here. I'd love for you guys to follow me on there just because the story aspect. I'm putting a lot of the behind the scenes stuff. You're getting to see more of my personal life on there. So knowing your audience, super important. Now, this I wanted to touch on digital meeting reality because a lot of the big brands are really, really getting involved on media over the last, I would say 3 to 5 years more so. And they're still not all in. When you look at television and everything else. So they're still not all in. So it's just, this is just the cusp of what's to come. But you see the kernel here for KFC. And I'm not sure how many people are familiar with the new kernel that's here. He's on the beach with his girlfriend. He's eating chicken. You know, he's hanging out and he's not even real. So he's a CGI, which is a computer generated image. But he is selling chicken and he's showing off how he's doing it all over the place. And, I think that's something that's kind of innovative for KFC to have put onto the table. Then you have Chick-fil-A and Wendy's. So for those of you not on Twitter, I'm not on Twitter too much, but I am there. And I will tell you that Wendy's is the savages. They are the savages of Twitter. If you say anything to them, doesn't matter if you're regular Joe down the street or big brand, they will respond to you if you catch their attention. So here you see Chick-fil-A posting. Is there anything better than enjoying one of our spicy chicken sandwiches on a Friday afternoon? Wendy's jumps into their feed and says, yes, enjoying one of ours on a Sunday. Obviously, Chick-fil-A is closed on Sundays. And what Wendy's did here, believe me, there was much more thought process to people marketing and doing the behind the scenes stuff than just posting on Chick-fil-A and giving them a burn kind of thing. They were infiltrating Chick-fil-A's feed and they knew it. And they were going to start gathering people and pulling people from the Chick-fil-A feed to do that. There's tactics involved here. And then you have number three here, David Dobrik, who is a monster YouTuber, 18 million plus YouTubers. And I believe it was 2019, he had a National Burrito Day. They dubbed him Dobrik Burrito. It drove sales through the roof. And, you know, what this is all about really is showing you the power of brand and the power of marketing through these digital channels. Now, these are obviously on much bigger levels, but think about your market. Think about where you are. Think about how you want to maybe infiltrate in someone's feed and start, you know, posting and engaging in some of those people's feeds. Think about maybe how you want to collaborate with somebody that's big in the industry or big in your market from a rep group or a manufacturer dealer, and start using, you know, utilizing these collaborations to put marketing things together. It's all about engaging and interacting and building. That's what it's really all about. So moving forward to community. Community is king, not content, okay? And I say this because I'm seeing it head on right now in Facebook, in the group, the Food Equipment Digital Disruptor group, community. And there was no content coming through the group that was, you know, selling or doing anything. It was just industry hot topics. There's things going on yesterday blowing up about, they're talking about stuff with being on hold with manufacturers for a long time. And there's a lot of pain points that we're all working through. And this really started a big conversation. And there's big conversations happening every week in this community. So it wasn't content that is bringing people together. It's the community and the issues and the things that we all work with on a daily basis. And that kind of shows with the Fed conference. You know, I'm just a guy from Jersey that started shooting videos and putting my authentic self out there. I started a community on Facebook, and I was able to put together a conference with people that believed in the cause. You know, we had sponsors, people were paying for tickets. I mean, this is still mind blowing to me that even happened. It's humbling. It's one of the most humbling things that have ever happened in my life. And it all happened through community on Facebook. So Food Equipment Digital Disruptors, if you're not there, get over there. And we have a new website coming, so we'll stay tuned for that. But a lot of the things that also the Fed Group stands for is networking and putting on events. It's also going to stand for helping with the skilled trades gap and talking with some of these schools and local areas that we can start talking about. How do we get these technicians? How do we get new technicians? How do we get it excited? I want this to be the place that happens, which also plays on you. So if you have a business, if you have a brand you're building, I urge you this week to begin a Facebook group. Start a Facebook group around your business if you'd like, or around your brand, or whatever might be on your mind. And please always reach out to me. You can get me anyway. I'm happy to help in any way. It's super, super important that you start building community around your brand. And people are asking me all the time, how are you putting out this content? How are you doing it? So this is a list. This is a list of what I'm using. Canva, okay? You could download the app. You could do a lot of graphics design stuff. Matter of fact, this exact photo was done in Canva. Okay, Adobe Spark, download it on your phone. I use it every single day editing my photos. InShot, you will see tons of my videos that I'm doing on a daily basis, holding my phone just like this and editing all my videos. It is very easy to use. It's like $3 or $4 a month for the paid version. Do it. And just practice. The more you do it, the better you'll get at it, and you'll probably enjoy it. And then when you start seeing some of the return and the engagement, you're going to want to really keep doing it. Again, Facebook groups, create the community. You need to do this week. You can't wait. 2021 is coming. The calendar pages are going to keep ripping off. You're going to keep putting things to the side. You got to do it. You got to do it now. And Hootsuite. I just got involved with Hootsuite. Post scheduling, it is a savior. Saturday night, Sunday morning, whatever you want to do, put these posts together. Go on Adobe Spark, go on InShot, put these all little videos, little minute videos, post together, go into Hootsuite, schedule it for the week out for 9 a.m., 2 p.m., 3 p.m. And lo and behold, all of a sudden you're posting like crazy, and you can still run your business during the week and not worry about having to, I got to post, because we do got to be consistent. That's the name of the game. So in closing, before I go on to the next slide here, in closing, this is about creating opportunity. That's what this is really all about. It's about building your brand. It's about of course, listen, we're all in the same industry. We're all pulling from the same customers. We want to bring industry awareness to the social media. We want people to know about us. It's one of my buddies said, this is the biggest little industry I've ever found to be in my life. And it's so true. We're huge, but we're so small. We're so connected. We need to put it out there. We need to talk more about it. And I know through Fed, we're going to do that. And hopefully as you build your communities, invite me in, invite people in. Shout out to Jason Wange, who started the Food Service Power Plant Network, which is taking off. It's happening, folks. So be a part of it. Don't be a wallflower. Don't hold up the wall, as my father used to say. Get out there and be a part of it. Participate in the things that are happening around you. I promise you that the payoff will come with your efforts in time. Last thing I want to say is I have a new phone number. I would love for you to join my community. That's the number right there, 201-485-5159. We're going to be engaging there. We can get in touch there. You'll get notified about different things that are going on in Fed and different things that are happening maybe around the industry. So I'd love for you to join my community. Brand new. This is the very first time I'm releasing that number. I just got it today. Brand new for this group. So I appreciate it. If you wouldn't mind following me on YouTube, I'm Maliki TV, and everywhere, really, at Rich Maliki everywhere. And then lastly, I would love to have everybody in the Fed group, because I know there's going to be strength in numbers to get these things done. And with that, I guess I could open up to questions if that's okay.
Yeah, Rich, I'm going to jump in here just to chat about a couple things, and maybe that'll get some Q&A spurred. I like the list of tools that you had there in the one slide. It's an interesting mix of things. And then, you know, I've learned quite a bit about branding. I mentioned in my morning session with my personal introduction, I race stock cars on the weekend. So I've had to learn about branding just to try to get sponsors for that, right? So, and I don't think people really understand what a personal brand means. You know, they overlook that aspect of it, and it's you struggle with it. Like you said, you work for a company and they're successful, so why should you bother with it? But the thing is like, I know I've kind of embraced some of the things that make me who I am, right? I've always had super long hair. So with my race team, I started running with the hashtag Mullet Nation, and I call all of my racing fans the Mullet Nation, right? And then we started selling t-shirts that have Mullet Nation on the back of them. So sometimes you just have to grab those things and latch onto it and run with it, and it will help you create that brand. And then, so as far as your list of tools, it's interesting that you posted Hootsuite on there. I've messed around with that a little bit, and it's a really powerful tool. I think to get the most out of it, you really have to get into the paid version of it instead of the free version. And yes. One other thing that I use quite a bit is Quark Express. It's a neat little tool, and it's very similar to Canva, where you can just grab a bunch of pics, throw them together, arrange them, throw some text on there. And I've even done full sponsorship proposals in Quark Express just like within minutes. So that's another tool that I think is really great. And then as far as, you know, social media, man, I agree with you that Facebook can be hit and miss. It's got its good and it's got its bad, right? And I try to stay out of the politics. You know, if anybody looks at my personal Facebook page, it's a lot of food that I'm cooking for dinner, because remember the days when Facebook was happy and it was, hey, look at my new boat, you know?
Yeah, it's changed.
Yeah, it has. So sometimes it gets difficult to manage all of those different social media channels, because like you, I've got a Facebook fans page for my racing team. I've got Instagram, I've got Twitter, you know, there's a lot going on. And then business-wise, there's LinkedIn, and trying to figure out how to communicate with the other people that you need to communicate with. Like you showed that slide of Wendy's jumping in on, and you're right, they are savage.
They are.
But it's great. The fans love it, right?
They do.
So I think I'm going to say, if anybody wants to see how to do that well, as far as all you designers out there and consultants, and I know like, to be quite frank, when you get right down to the bottom of it, he's our competitor here at Clevenger. But look at what James Camacho does on LinkedIn and Facebook. The guy is crushing it. He is on it. You know, he knows what he's doing. He posts intelligently. He communicates with his architects that he's working with in just a brilliant manner. So if anybody's looking for a template, I'm going to tell you, look at what James Camacho is doing on LinkedIn and Facebook and follow that. Okay. So that's kind of, and like I said, he's kind of our competition, but man, I look at what he's doing to see what I should be doing. And I would recommend that everybody else take a look at that. So now we've got a couple questions coming in, and Chris would like to ask, is ad spending worthwhile? And if so, through which social platforms?
So my personal opinion, and this, again, for everybody, it might be different. I did do some ad spend on Facebook and Instagram over the past couple of years. I did not find it to be worthwhile for me, my business, and my brand. It was just a lot of money going down a hole, I think. You know, but again, depending on what market you're in, and depending on what your product or service or what it is you're trying to sell or what you're trying to promote, there absolutely is worth looking into. But I will say this, there's a science to that ad spending. And I will also say that I'm not very good at that. So I think I probably would need to do even a lot more homework to figure out how to do that. But for me, I would steer clear of that at this point for me. And I would say, focus on LinkedIn, focus on putting out lots of content every day, focus on engaging, and you will begin to see that your network is going to expand and explode. So I just don't have enough knowledge in ad spending to really say yay or nay. I think it's just a personal journey for you.
Good answer. Appreciate that. So James says inspiring, and I'm going to take some of the energy that you left me with and get to updating my social sites. And then also he'd like to ask, what do you spend each month on social connection and subscriber fees? Also, my son works for Wendy's, and I'm sure he would have appreciated your comments.
what do I spend on social, the time that I spend on social networks?
I'm not sure. He says, what do you spend each month on social connection and subscriber fees?
So, I mean, I'm not spending any money dollar-wise. I'm spending time. That's really what I'm sacrificing. And if you want to call it paying, I'm paying with my time, countless hours probably throughout my day. I've incorporated it into my day. So, you know, when I wake up in the morning, I gather some things together. You'll see me posting on LinkedIn throughout the day and the night. There's really no money I'm investing at this point. The money I would invest is in my media manager to continue to help me put a lot of this stuff out, which right now I'm looking for a new one. But I'm not really spending dollars. I'm doing it all organic, bootstrapping kind of thing, reaching out to people, connecting with people, sending messages to people, and just staying engaged.
Yeah, he did clarify. So you're not spending money on advertising.
Not a cent.
Yeah, and I would agree that it's a massive time investment. I don't think people understand. You know, I always look at even like a website or social media in particular. This is something else that I've learned from my years of trying to promote my racing, that it can never be static. You can't just put it up there and then walk away. It's a living, breathing thing. And just like a kid, you have to feed it every day. Otherwise it dies.
It's true. I mean, listen, you look at sports metaphors, you're only as good as your last at bat, right? You have to continue to develop your brand, continue to talk about your message and be consistent with the message. Don't feel like, oh, I said this yesterday, say it again. And then 2 days later, say it again. Keep talking about your truths and what you feel about whatever issue might be going on in your business, whatever might be happening. You know, my service guys, our technicians, talk about the things that are happening. If you're having sales meetings, you don't have to put out, you know, all the secrets that you're doing, but put stuff out there to be transparent and show the world what you're up to. you know, and you got to do this consistently every day. And over time, like I said, opportunities are going to, they're just going to happen. Opportunities you had no idea existed. I never wanted to speak. And I got, you know, I'm speaking here today. I'm speaking on the RIFMA stage in Denver this past March. These are things that I never knew I even wanted, but now that they're beginning to present themselves, I'm just excited about it. And I know that down the line, you know, I'll be able to monetize, I'll be able to build a stronger business. So yeah, you got to stay consistent.
Yeah, so James wants to know, how do you use the media manager?
So my media manager that I the gentleman's name I had was Angel Quiroz, and he was with me for almost 2 years. It was kind of like a, and if you're familiar with Gary Vee, you can go check him out in D-Rock. So Angel kind of followed me around the industry. He came to conferences with me constantly. We're always filming, ABF, always be filming, right? So we're always filming, and we filmed meetings that we could film and put out stuff that we could put out. We walked the show floor at NRA. We walked the show floor at NAFM. I'm stopping in booths. I'm talking with manufacturers, and he was following me around the entire time. I was mic'd up. Stuff in the building with Tip Tuesday. We're filming Tip Tuesdays. We're filming gold collar videos. We're filming top five videos. He's constantly gathering this content, and he was constantly editing it and putting it out on YouTube, Facebook, LinkedIn. In 2019, we did a video a day. So that was very tough, but that's what he was there for. And he was also there to assist with a lot of stuff for Fed Nation and the conference and some graphic design work. So that's really what my media manager, in the sense, what he did.
Awesome. So Joe Carbonero says, really interesting, Rich. Admire your passion, commitment, and energy. How do you measure the effectiveness of your efforts? And this is something that I've struggled with on social media as well. So I'm really looking forward to hearing your answer.
So, yeah, I mean, obviously numbers, right? Data is super important in business and in media. You're looking at this from a business perspective. So for me, I'm probably different than many people. Everyone has their own thing. So I'm looking at numbers that the platforms give you. So I could look at Instagram and I could see what I did last week versus this week. You know, we could track the followers, we could track the engagement, we could track where these followers are coming from, female, male. We could track all these things. We look at them. We're trying to see what posts work and what ones don't. So you can go into Instagram and you utilize all their analytics. Okay. You could do this on all the platforms. They all offer that. I recommend that being where you start. That's kind of where I still am with all of it and just kind of tracking and seeing what posts work. So if I see like a video that I do, like my you versus you videos are doing pretty well. So I'm starting to do a little bit more of those, more motivational stuff. So incorporating some of that from the entrepreneur business aspect, because we're such a niche market or niche industry. You know, people don't know about us. We know about us. There's thousands of us. So, you know, the more we do it, the more these people, we're going to get them into our feed, into our subscribers. But aside from that, I track it by the business opportunities that have been coming my way. Like I said, through LinkedIn alone, you know, we've picked up a school district. We picked up Chipotle. We've picked up a Shake Shack. There's a lot of things that accumulated through that by people saying, hey, go check this out. So there's actual things, business dollars that you could look at to say, okay, this came because of the efforts on LinkedIn and the consistency. Let's keep going. Let's keep doing this. And let's keep putting out this content. You got to look at the analytics of what's working. You could see the post. If you have numbers, you know, on a post that does, you know, 1500 views, you know, you're getting 47 comments. Like, what was it about this video? Let's do more videos like this. So sometimes I'll have controversial stuff that I'll put up, and I'm like asking questions about parts distribution and how people are handling, you know, service companies are handling that with customers trying to supply their own parts. And believe me, the service guys and girls, they want to chime in. They want to talk about that. And, you know, you'll start to see more engagement, more things. And all of a sudden you'll have people reaching out. Hey, Rich, I really love that post you did. Hey, listen, you're going to be around next week. I'm going to be in town. You know, we really love for you guys to rep our manufacturer in New Jersey. So you're going to track it that way. And then you're going to track the analytics, just using the analytics within each platform.
Thanks for that. That's a great answer. Lou says that LinkedIn has been king since 2001 for opportunities.
Yeah. And keep in mind, right now, I would say LinkedIn and TikTok are the only two platforms left that there's any room for organic growth. And it's probably going to be ending soon, because I didn't check recently, but I think LinkedIn is closing in on 1 billion users. And once it gets to 1 billion, it's going to get a lot harder to be seen. So make sure we're taking the next 3, 4, 5, 6 months to really begin building up and ramping up on LinkedIn.
Yeah, that's crazy. I think I'm maybe a little bit too old to really understand TikTok, but
yeah, TikTok's a funny one. I'm not fully into it yet. I'm trying, but I think we need to be there. I just got to figure out we got to figure out what it is that it's going to be for us. I feel like how-to videos might work on there because there's so many how-to things going on there now, but you got to make it fun.
Yeah, exactly. It has to be fun. And you know, from the consultant design side of things, I think there's a big use here for just quick little videos on projects that we're working on and what's new in the industry and trends that we're seeing and those kinds of things. I think, you know, you start doing that and it helps build your brand because now people are listening to you as what's coming in the future or what's going on right now. And if ever there was a time to be doing that, that's right now because people need something to see, right?
It's true. There's never been a better time. That's why I shouted out my buddy, Jason Wange. I guess I'm sure you know him.
I don't.
Oh, you don't know Jason? Okay. Well, he started something on Facebook too, the Food Service Power Plant Network. And he's starting to do these live interviews. He did it with Allison Cody, director of MOFC. I mean, so he's had a lot of people on there talking, and that's right now is the time. Right now is the time. The world is going to come back, ladies and gentlemen. The world is going to come back full throttle at some point, hopefully maybe Q2 of 2021, I'm hoping. And time is not going to be something you probably have a lot of. So right now is the best time to get started. And once you get started and you're locked in, boy, you know what? I'll tell you, I feel like I have a obligation at this point. I've done it for so much and so long. I feel obligated. It's part of my daily. I got to do it. Like the gym, like getting up and going to work, my media, it's part of my life. And so start now and get excited.
All right. Thanks, Rich. It's a lot of thought-provoking ideas. And I encourage everybody to take steps to build your personal brand and your digital footprint. I want to kick it over to Janelle. She's got a couple poll questions that she wants to ask everybody. So let's go to her for that.
Hey, thanks so much, Rich. I thought to make this a little bit more interactive, we might go ahead and launch a couple of polls. So I'm going to go with the first one here. You guys should all be seeing that on your screen. Do you have a LinkedIn profile?
Of course.
Well, I like that response.
Yeah, that's pretty positive.
That's a good one, right? All right, let's try another one. Do you actively use social media to promote you and your brand?
Uh-oh.
This one's fun, it's gonna vary a little bit more.
I think a lot of somewhats maybe are coming, let's see.
That's kind of what I'm predicting too.
Let's see if you guys are right. Yeah, pretty all across the board, huh? Oh, it didn't work, did it? Hold on.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah, wow.
You just need a cool hashtag, like Fed Nation.
That's it, Get it and roll.
Swag too, you gotta have the swag, right? all right, let's try one more. What platform? Oh, that didn't work out. Do you use?
Now, Rich is going to select all of them.
Yeah, that's all me.
And then he's going to start writing in a few more.
That's right. I think we'll see LinkedIn is.
You know, it's funny. I use every single one of those except for TikTok.
Yeah. Yeah. I have the TikTok. I'm not super active.
And Twitter was not up there. So I'm using one that's not on that.
I couldn't type fast enough to add it.
Oh. So almost everybody's on LinkedIn. And then we got more Instagram than anything else.
Wow.
I think TikTok's still. There's a lot of people that don't really understand it. So,
you know what? And honestly, it's like the 10, 11, 12, 13 year olds that are on there for the most part. If you look,
YouTube's a tough one because it's difficult to figure out what it is you want to film, right?
Yeah. Yeah. YouTube. I mean, listen, you could do a lot with YouTube. I know Josh Zolan is a big advocate for the how-to videos. He does really well with them. So there's a lot of different, things. You just got to figure out, you know, you gotta, it's just a trial and error, honestly.
Yeah. And for me, you know, with my race team, it's easy because I got in-car cameras, everybody's got a GoPro, right? So I'm posting that stuff on there. I'm editing some of that footage with external cameras that are in the stands that I give to my family and making promotional videos and that sort of thing. But from the consultant designer side of things, which is the people in this audience, you know, I can easily see like maybe some drone footage of a project that you're working on that's being built. That's always cool, right?
Definitely. Oh yeah, that'll get some views.
Or a walkthrough of a commercial kitchen that you just finished up when you're there for the punch list. Almost every phone these days, I don't think people realize it, but the cameras in them are better than what we had 15 years ago in a handheld camcorder, because you know the cameras on these phones are amazing now, right? So use that thing to film a quick walkthrough of the kitchen that you're doing the punch list on, and then that can become YouTube footage or Facebook footage or you know whatever. Later on when you get it edited and maybe, you know, add some extra, like an intro slide that talks about your company or whatever.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I just did a walkthrough at the Habit Burger in Union. We went through the list. We were showcasing the manufacturers, talking with the facilities director a little bit about it. 3 minutes, no more than that. And it did really well.
All right, Rich. Well, I really appreciate your time. Thank you for giving us a lot of great ideas and really appreciate your speech there.
I appreciate you guys having me. I hope it helped a little bit. And yeah, happy holidays to everybody too.
All right. Well, we all know this has been one hell of a year, or whatever choice word you want to use when referring to 2020. Whether it's the shortage of toilet paper, the wearing of masks, closing of restaurants, it's been nothing less than unbelievable. We want to join everybody together just to kind of raise a toast to the industry and our little community here and just say, here's to 2021, right?
2021.
Janelle, any last thoughts from you?
Yes, I was trying to share our camera so we could cheers with you guys. But hold on one sec. I'm gonna see if I can. All right. Okay, I think we're live. All right. I just wanna say thanks so much to Rich. Thanks to all the speakers. You know, every time I listen to our industry experts share information, I'm more amazed. And yeah, I just really am grateful to be a part of this awesome industry. We lose me?
Yeah, thank you so much, you know.
All right, thanks a lot. I wanna thank everyone for joining us for this 2 days. It's been a whirlwind tour, and hopefully we'll see you all in the new year. Have a great new year, everybody. Bye.
Thank you, take care.
Thank you, take care, everyone.